Today I'm going to show you how to make an epoxy tabletop using the EpoxAcast 690 clear epoxy resin. Now, this project came about because of the need that I had for opening up a wall that's between the living room and the kitchen. And I know I wanted to put some kind of slab there so we can sit on both sides for eating breakfast, so I decided to make my own. Now, I saw a lot of the epoxy river tables that people are making, but somehow that just didn't struck my fancy. And since I just recently finished the flooring in the house, I had some leftover hardwood flooring, and I wanted to upcycle this into the table. So let's just jump into this project, and let me show you how I've solved this problem. The leftover flooring pieces are cut to shapes and sizes according to the design that I have in mind for this project. And then we can proceed to prep the working surface. This is going to be made on top of a melamine board. First, we're going to clean it, and then we're going to go ahead and adhere the sides of the table that we're making, and I want to mention that these are going to be incorporated into the table, so these edges are going to stay when the table is finished. So we're going to go ahead and glue these together using some wood glue to each other, but then I'm using the hot melt glue to actually adhere them to the working surface. Make sure that the frame is square. And then I'm going to proceed around the perimeter until I have the rectangle fully built. Keep in mind that these pieces are also left over from the flooring that I just cut down to size so that they will form a frame. Now, a quick check, make sure that the working surface is leveled, and we can proceed to the material. Now, the product we're using for this project, again, is the EpoxAcast 690. This is a clear epoxy that we're going to be pigmenting. But what's really important for this product that it's a 108 to 30B by weight. So we do need to use an accurate gram scale here. The working time of the material is 5 hours, while a full cure is achieved in 24 hours. But one important aspect about this material is that it does require a release agent to be able to release from surfaces. And for that, we're going to follow the instructions in the technical bulletin, and it calls for the ease release 200 or the 205. And in this case, I'm going to be using the 205. This is a liquid version of the 200. And in this case, because it's liquid, it's definitely more potent as far as where you're applying the material. So I can simply brush this over the entire working surface, knowing that everything is covered and the casting will release from that surface. Once the release agent is applied, we're going to allow that to dry for about 20 minutes before proceeding on to the next step. Now, one more aspect of this project, we're doing a step pour. So we're going to pour a first layer, then a second and a third. And it's important to take a look at the technical bulletin as far as instructions for this material. You should be pouring this in 3/8 of an inch or 0.95 centimeters. That's the recommended thickness. Otherwise, the epoxy can overheat and potentially cause all kinds of cracking and bubbling up. And to prevent that, we want to stick to those guidelines laid out for us in the technical bulletin. But before proceeding, I do follow the instructions and pre-mix the part A of the EpoxAcast 690. I'm using a drill mixer here with a drill, and then we're going to dispense the part A to mix the first batch. To see a more in-depth procedure on how to dispense from a 5-gallon container, just click on the link above here. And once you have the Part A dispense, we're going to dispense the UVO black. This is UV-resistant pigment, and also we're going to be dispensing it by weight. We're not just going to be estimating. We're going to definitely use the gram scale. We're going to add 2% of the total weight in pigment. Once the pigment is added to our part A, we can go ahead and mix that in thoroughly. I'm going to use a mechanical mixer here with a drill. I'm going to mix that in thoroughly, scrape the sides, scrape the bottom, even when you're mixing with a drill mixer like this. And then we can go ahead and dispense the part B into our mixture. Once again, I'm going to be using the mechanical mixer here with the drill, and I'm going to scrape the sides, scrape the bottom with the mixer, and then once I'm done mixing, I'm going to use a mixing stick and again scrape the sides, scrape the bottom off the mixing container, because that's where unmixed material likes to collect. Now, once that is mixed, we can go ahead and dispense the first layer into our buildup, into our mold, so to say. Now, this first layer that we're applying is a very thin application. Basically, we're putting a foundation down that is going to not only seal the edges around the perimeter so that the material cannot leak out after we pour a large quantity into it, but it will also set the depth level that I need to set the inlay of the wood that we're pre-cut so that it actually levels out with the top edge of our mold box here, or the perimeter that we built. And to pop the air bubbles that are created in the mixing process, I'm simply going to run a propane torch over the epoxy. Before I walk away from this pour, I know that the pot life of the material is 5 hours, which is extremely long, and that's fine. I just want to go around the perimeter, make sure there's no leaks. If there is some small leaks, I'm using some Sculptix oil-based clay to plug those up, and then we're going to allow the material a full cure of 24 hours. Now, after our first layer had a full cure of 24 hours, we can proceed to mixing a smaller batch of the epoxy. We're going to follow the same dispense and mix procedure. And then we're going to dispense that on top of the already cured epoxy. And basically what we're building here is a layer that the inlay wood is going to be set into. This is going to be more or less an adhesive layer. We're going to use this epoxy as an adhesive to glue the wood into place. Now we're going to start to lay out the design that we created using the leftover wood. And I'm going to use some painter's tape here, some blue tape. I'm going to lay out basically a guidance cross right in the middle. That way I know where my center is, where my focal point is. And that also is going to help me align the rest of the design into the epoxy. You can use extra tape like I did here to hold the actual design in place so none of the wood blocks would float or wander off. So some of the blue tape is now added to the top of these design pieces, top of the wood blocks, to keep them in place. Now that our design is inlaid into the fresh epoxy, we can walk away from this and allow it a full cure for 24 hours before returning and basically flooding the rest of the void to bring the epoxy to the level of the frame that we built. So again, allow this a full cure for 24 hours before proceeding on to the next step. All right, now the epoxy has had a full cure for 24 hours and we're ready to do the final pour. First, I'm going to remove all that extra tape and then I'm going to proceed to dispensing and mixing the EpoxAcast 690 just like we did previous. Make sure you're dispensing by weight and also using the pigment by weight. Once that is mixed, we can go ahead and slowly pour this into our table cavity. And I want to pour basically till the epoxy reaches the level off the edges, off the tabletop. And it doesn't matter if it goes over the wood a little bit since we're going to be sanding this down anyways, but allow this now a full 24-hour cure before proceeding on to removing this from the working surface. 24 hours later, we're ready to remove our tabletop from our working surface, and you can see how easily that slides off the working surface. Now, to finish our project, we need to sand the top of our tabletop here. And I'm simply going to run it through the sander at a rough grit, about 60 to 100, to remove most of that epoxy over the top that flooded over some of the wood pieces. That's fine. I expected that. I'm just going to run this through until I see all the wood inlay that we did exposed. After that, I'm going to use a palm sander, as you can see here, and I'm going simply bring that grit up from 100. We're going to go to a 220, 400, 600, 800, and finally 1,000 to give us a nice smooth finish on the actual table. Keep in mind that I'm aiming here for a matte finish, not a gloss finish. So sanding the surface to 1,000 grit is kind of a semi-gloss matte finish. And that's exactly what we want to get. To finish the project, we're going to apply some linseed oil. This is going to help to seal the wood. I didn't want to use any kind of spray over the top here. I just wanted to use something that's going to seep into the wood and give it a nice protection and yet protect and keep the semi-gloss or matte finish off the epoxy. So linseed oil worked great for me here. Once I applied it and let it seep in, I came back and buffed it out. Wiped it down and buffed it out, and the piece is now ready for installation. For the install, I actually needed to rip a hole into the wall here. So we did a little bit of construction at home, and now I'm just ready to slide that in and see how it looks. This is the first test fit. It looks pretty good. Now the tabletop is screwed in from the bottom into studs, so that it actually has support. And that's pretty much it. And here you can see the table actually in use. We're having some breakfast on here, and I really love the way that this turned out. The surface finish is absolutely stunning, and I'm really glad I didn't have to coat it with anything else. I can simply wipe off anything, any stains, any water from this without having to worry of it seeping into the wood or leaving any stains on the epoxy. Now, if you got inspired by this project and you'd like to give your own projects a go and need some material, you can visit any one of our distributors around the world.
There you have it, a step-by-step procedure on how I made this epoxy tabletop using the EpoxAcast 690. Now, if you have an idea about what we should do next, please let us know down in the comments below. And if you like this video, hit the thumbs up button. Now, to keep up with our latest mold making and casting videos, remember to subscribe.